Hi there, my name is Zoran Horvat. Today I will talk to you about optional objects, how you can create your own implementation of optional objects and use them when creating powerful, flexible, extendable domain models in your own project. As you probably know already, C# does not support optional objects yet, until the day comes when the language will support optional objects. I hope that day will come. We either need to use any of the publicly available libraries on the internet or create our own implementation. There are several popular libraries that include optional objects among many other things, but let me tell you a secret, I'm not using any of those in production projects I create. Why? Because I don't need to. Creating optional objects takes no more than 5 minutes time, but using optional objects in domain modeling takes a lot of knowledge. You need to know what you're doing. So stay with me through this video and I will show you all minute details about creating and using optional objects in domain modeling. Let's begin. This is the minimum implementation of the option class. It is generic, it wraps around an object. I have only supported reference types so far. And then an option, an object of the option class, would be an optional object of type T, an object that might not be there or might be there. You don't know when you receive an option object. One note before we start diving into tons of code that are awaiting you in this video. If you have any troubles to understand what optional objects are, why we need them, what is the difference between optional objects and nullable references, please watch the video that precedes this one where I have covered that kind of questions. Then get back and continue from this point on and you will see how to use that knowledge in designing domain models. Let's get on. There are two appearances of the option, some and none. Some contains an object, none contains none. And the most important method defined on the option is map. It is applying a function, this func delegate, which knows nothing about optional objects. I would say that the map function passed as the argument to the map method is a function which operates on definite objects, objects that do exist. And option type is helping us apply that definite function to an optional object, that is objects that might not be there at runtime. That is the power of option. Another useful method is reduce. Reduce is helping us pull out the value from the option if it is there or substitute it with the default if it's not there. This is the demo model of person with possibly missing a last name. Some valid persons only have the first name. To warm up, let's see how we convert this person object to a string. We would map an existing last name to full name string, but if the last name was missing, it was none, then we reduce the entire name to just a full name. This is the principal way how you use optional objects. Map, 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 and eventually reduce to return a concrete object that always exists. Optional objects are bridging the gap between objects that might or might not be there and functions that always request an object to produce a result. For example, I want to transform a name, a string name, to its initial letter. This function doesn't know anything about possibly missing names, and it has a lot of things to think about. For example, if the length of this name is zero, then there is no initial letter. There's a lot of logic to isolate the initial letter, to turn it to uppercase, and even this small function contains a bug that I will fix later, but look. What I'm trying to tell you is that when you are dealing with domain logic, you will have hands full of problems of your own. On top of the question whether the object you wanted to pass to a function exists in the first place. So don't think about non-existent objects when dealing with domain logic. Focus on the logic itself and do it right in one place, isolated in a function with definite objects, which doesn't know anything about the possibility of objects of its arguments being missing. That is the single responsibility principle, if you want it that way. Now, dealing with a person, that is an entirely different responsibility from the other function, because the person's last name could be missing. So let's start from that optional object and map it by applying that definite function to it optionally. If the last name were there, it would be passed to this function. If not, it would not be passed to this function. Now we have two separate ways out from this situation, because this map call would return an optional string, which either contains that capital letter or not. This whole function could return an optional string if there is no way to complete the operation, so we are telling to the caller that we might not be able to procure the initial letter for the person in all cases. The other way is to reduce this optional object to a definite result somehow. For example, the request could be to use the person's first name in cases when there is no last name. That is a legitimate request. And so here it is, the expression which always returns the capital letter no matter what. For example, we could take two persons, Thomas Mann with both first name and last name, and Aristotle with only the first name. We could print their initial letters uniformly using this function that takes the initial letter from a person. And this is the point when the things will become more complicated. This is another domain model, a book. The author of the book could be missing. Some books don't have a known author. Now we wish to categorize books under author's initials. Maybe we are holding all the books in a bookshelf in a store and we want to group them together based on the author's initial. How do we pull out the initial letter for a book? Well, apply that definite function, which always returns an initial letter, to optionally obtain an initial letter for a book, optionally because the author is optional. And give up. This function cannot create an initial letter if there is no author. So this function will always return an optional string and the caller will have to cope with the missing initial letter. So if we were assembling a bookshelf in the store, the person who arranges the books will have to manage. All right, this was the kindergarten of optional objects. From this point on, we will start dealing with some really complicated questions regarding optional objects, objects that might be missing. If you liked the video so far, this is the moment when you can press the like button, because some of those things that follow you might not like. Let's get on to unleashing the true power of optional objects. It will all start from the requirements. I will make more complicated requirements from this point on, and we will use optional objects to implement them. Here is one interesting requirement. We want to assemble a bookshelf. Take all the books we have in the library, group them by the author's initial. This won't work, because optional objects, as I have implemented them, do not implement value-typed semantic. I will fix that, don't worry, so we move on. Order by the initial letter and substitute the missing letter with an empty string, so put those books with no author first. I will show you what that bookshelf looks like. Suppose that we need to print the initial letter labels and place them in different places on the shelf for the customers to orientate them when looking for authors. And look, an optional MapReduce expression that will substitute the missing initial letter with an empty printed label. There are more requirements. I want to return optional string from the getInitial function rather than an empty string. This reduction to empty, that's not this function's responsibility to decide. Because one day it will be an empty string when there is no initial letter. The other day it will be some constant string like not exists or not found or whatever. It is the caller's decision what comes in place of a missing object, missing string in this example. So I want this function getInitial to return an optional string, and that will cause all other functions to chain that decision until the missing string is substituted with something that is opportune, that is useful in the current use case. Let's start improving the option type. What I want you is to stay with me till the very end so that you can see how I'm developing that option type and why exactly. That will also teach you how to use it. First, I want to implement that value typed semantic between the optional objects. Get hash code, it will just delegate to the content if it exists and reduce to zero if it doesn't exist. Very simple. Equals of object will delegate to strongly typed equals, and here it is, the strongly typed equals will carefully juggle around the nulls so to never dereference a null or send it inadvertently to the underlying object, which might make a wrong decision then. This is why option is so useful. It cares about nulls for you so that you don't have to repeat anything of this null-related code in your domain model. And of course, don't forget equality operators. Now, performance improvement. Reduce is accepting the else value that will be returned in case that this option doesn't contain an object. I don't like this because evaluating the else value might take time, might take resources. Why use those resources before we know that they will be used? This or else argument will be just thrown away in case that this option already contains the object. Let's implement the lazy evaluated reduce, the reduce variant which is accepting a func delegate and only invoking it if this option object does not contain a non-null reference. Now, an interview question for you. When will the null coalescing operator call the function? The correct answer is only when the right-hand side value is required. Null coalescing operator is lazy. It only evaluates its right-hand side if the left-hand side is null. If the left-hand side is not null, it ignores the right-hand side. Did you know that? How many members of your team know that? How often will members of your team remember to question this detail if they used a func delegate combined with the null coalescing operator? Wouldn't you love to have this conversation done to the end in one place, and the result, the correct result, the correct answer to this tough question implemented in just one place, this option type? You probably don't want null coalescing operators with func delegates written all over your code base, especially if not everybody know what that will really do when invoked. That is one of the reasons why we use classes to wrap technical knowledge, expertise inside of them. Let's move on. We can improve the optional objects API even further. We can define an operator called where. It accepts a predicate. And another variant, where not. You would not usually create a pair of methods with inverted logic, but in options, this turns useful because sometimes you will just pass an existing delegate, a method group, a lambda you already have. Will you have to wrap it into another lambda? Don't do that, just call where not and apply the same func delegate or the same method group in that place if you also need inverted logic. Another useful function, map optional. Maybe you already have a function which returns an optional object. We have that in the demo code over there and it's waiting for us. This is also the example of the so-called railway-oriented programming. You may have heard of that. This is a good example of it. If you haven't heard of it, go on, search the internet and learn about it. It's really a wonderful topic. And we can make options even easier to use or to create. We can attach extension methods to other types, like turning any nullable reference into an option, or implementing that where operator right on the nullable T, whatever that T might be. Beyond this point, you can create an entire link for optional objects. For example, imagine operators like first or none instead of first or default. I will not go that far in this demo, but again, go visit the GitHub repository with this implementation. You will find optional link there as well. I have also implemented option as a struct there to avoid needless heap allocations, and I have on top of that supported value types as well. Let's get back to the demo and complete it. The request was to return this function's result into an optional initial letter. Here, the where not operator applied to the string is null or white space, and that also solves that bug I had in this function. I'm not sure if you saw it. Now this function is correct. And then map it by isolating the first non-empty character or letter in the string, turning it to uppercase. This is domain logic implemented to the letter. The function above, its body is correct, but its return type is not. It must also return an optional string this time, and that reduce call, I want to pass the lambda to it to save resources in cases when the option on which the reduce is called already contains the result. I don't want this call get initial of a person first name to be made if the result is already there. Let's move up. Get outer initial, it only needs to use the map optional, and everything will be right with it. So many differences in details, do you see? In only 6 lines of code. Optional objects are enforcing declarative coding style. I have just declared what to do when there is an object and when there is not. And that is all. It just works. Before we split, let me run the application. It is grouping the books correctly. It is printing the empty label first. Everything works as requested. One last look at the code. There is not a single null in this application. It's not that I don't like nulls. It's that I don't know what null would tell if I passed it between functions. What does it mean to receive a null? With optional objects, when the object is not there, there is no call. The call becomes optional on an optional object. And that is probably the most powerful idea when talking about optional objects. They are changing the way you create domain models. That was all I have prepared for you in this video. I hope you have learned some valuable knowledge about optional objects and that you will use them in your domain modeling. Thank you for staying with me till the end, and see you in the next video.